From the headquarters of Telesur English in Quito, Ecuador, I am Estefania Bravo. This is From the South. April 7th will mark 1 year since former Brazilian President Luiz Inacio Lula da Silva was imprisoned. Many doubts remain about how his prosecution and sentencing were carried out and about the reasons behind his imprisonment. Let's find out more in the first part of our series looking into the life and work of the Latin America leader.
Many people in the world know the story of former President Luiz Inacio Lula da Silva. He was the only president who left office with an 87% approval rating, which is a record. But not many people know where Lula came from. We are in Caetes, in the state of Pernambuco, where Lula was born. It is a small town with only 28,000 residents. During the last election, most people here voted for the PT candidate, Fernando Haddad, who was backed by Lula and received 91.73% of votes during the runoff in this town.
After Lula became president, everything was much better. Everything changed. The poor did not have the right to go to university. Today they have.
Before Lula's government, we lived in misery. We tried to fight by using our votes, but there was no one helping us. But after Lula came to power, everything improved. Everything has improved thanks to Lula.
Luiz Inacio Lula da Silva was born on October 27, 1945, in a house just like this one, right in this piece of land. Lula still has family living here, such as Antonio Ferreira, Lula's cousin. He lives with Lula in Sao Paulo, but came back because he did not find a place in the big city. He recalls his cousin's time in power.
When Lula was in power, everything was easier for us. And not just for us because we are his family, because he never gave us anything, but because he gave many things to the country, to Brazil, to everyone who needed a house or access to water, anything.
Another cousin of Lula's, Heraldo Ferreira, who was also a part of the Workers' Party, said that the town where Lula was born, as well as the whole region, used to be a place to recruit cheap workers. It was only after the Workers' Party came to power when this changed.
The Workers' Party government, Lula's government, gave us dignity. It rebuilt the country. It made the country's resources available to the poorest regions for the first time.
April 7, the son of the small town of Caetes will have been in prison for 1 year. His trial was criticized by different lawyers and politicians from Brazil and around the world. Residents of Caetes hope that Lula can be freed soon and once again rule the country, continuing the social reforms that gave all people dignity.
Indigenous campesino and Afro-descendant communities continue to mobilize in Colombia after more than 3 weeks of protests that have often been repressed by the police. Demonstrators have reported more police repression in the city of Popayan as the presence has intensified. On Tuesday, activist Deinid Seferino Yunda Camayo was shot dead by police during one of the social Minga protests in the department of Valle del Cauca. Communities demand that the government fulfill its agreements regarding their lands and rights. The dialogue between them and the government was called off on Tuesday, as the protesters say the government has not agreed to certain guarantees.
We are very concerned about what the Minister of Defense has said. We are victims because they have fired on us. They fired on us in El Cairo, in the tunnel, in Suarez, and they fired on us even in Patico, a town where a lot of indigenous people and campesinos have been victimized, because the security forces are using live ammunition on us. There is evidence of that. There are videos. The defense minister has said he doesn't care about human rights, nor about life. Therefore, the defense minister is responsible for everything that happens here during the Minga.
Meanwhile, activists in Belgium continue their march towards The Hague to deliver a letter to the International Court of Justice. They're demanding an end to the persecution of social leaders in Colombia. On Wednesday, they were joined by Colombian senators Gustavo Petro and Gustavo Bolívar, who expanded why this march and the Mingas are taking place.
The international community does not care about the real issues facing Latin America. The region is only seen as a giant oil exporter. Our social needs and struggles have all been ignored. We are trying to reignite the fight for peace and democracy and are calling on the progressive parties in the EU to support us. This will place much needed international attention on our need for peace and democracy. Latin America cannot continue to be the land of death, violence, and authoritarianism. The dictatorships from 30 years ago, which stifled our hope in democracy, are returning. Now, Latin America must forge a new path through democracy and peace.
Colombia is marred by impunity. These armed groups are never prosecuted. We hope that the relevant international bodies will help us. The Inter-American Commission for Human Rights has already heard our demands, and we hope the ICJ will intervene and launch an investigation in Colombia.
On Tuesday, Venezuela's National Constituent Assembly approved the government's Plan de la Patria 2019-2025. ANC President Diosdado Cabello says the approval is in compliance with the Venezuelan Constitution.
I want to ask this assembly to approve the Plan de la Patria 2019-2025. So legislators in agreement signal, as is customary, with two hands, for the nation, for Chavez, for Maduro, for children, women, youth, soldiers, workers, for people with disabilities, for Afro-descendants, for sexual diversity, for the elderly, for the whole nation, approved the Plan de la Patria 2019-2025.
President Nicolás Maduro expressed his satisfaction with the approval of this law through social media on Tuesday. The president said he was grateful to the National Constituent Assembly for the approval of the Plan de la Patria, which has become a constitutional law. The document was debated across the country and on commissions inside the legislative body. And Venezuela's National Constituent Assembly also approved the constituent decree to strip immunity from opposition figure Juan Guaido. He has played a central role in an attempted coup against President Nicolás Maduro. The body also ordered authorities to continue an investigation into Guaido. He has been under investigation since January, when he violated a travel ban by visiting a group of countries whose leaders recognize him as interim president. Venezuela will leave the Organization of American States by April 27th after authorities condemned its interventionist policies and promotion of a coup in the country. Venezuela's ambassador to the UN, Samuel Moncada, accused the head of the organization, Luis Almagro, of seeking to bypass the necessary 24 votes in the General Assembly to request an invasion for humanitarian reasons. He said the OAS cannot unilaterally recognize governments or allow other countries, like the U.S., to impose its recognition on other nations. The Venezuelan Foreign Minister Jorge Arreaza has met the Lebanese President Michel Aoun during his official visit to the country. Via social media, Arreaza thanked the Lebanese President for his solidarity and support of Venezuela and his respect for international law. The leaders gathered to strengthen ties and reinforce cooperation between both countries. The Venezuelan Foreign Minister arrived in Lebanon on Wednesday after visiting Turkey in a tour that will next take him to Syria. The Mexican president has said that closing the border with the U.S. will benefit no one. This after U.S. President Donald Trump has continued to lobby threats about closing it.
No nos conviene.
Closing the border would not be good for anyone. It's not the most advisable decision. I'm glad the U.S. government has already recognized that we're helping, and we're going to continue doing so.
The large number of migrants detained at the U.S. border with Mexico has led to many being released. The U.S. government decided to reduce congestion at its detention centers by taking migrants hundreds of kilometers to cities like Albuquerque, San Antonio, and Phoenix. They were later released at truck stops or near churches. U.S. migration figures show that more than 125,000 migrants have been released from detention with their families. Moving on, in Peru, the General Workers Union is staging a protest to reject the economic policies of President Martín Vizcarra. Workers and unions from Arequipa have called for other organizations to join them and reject the government's labor reform. They consider the plan only favors big capitalists. Workers are also marching to oppose water privatization and in solidarity with the Fuerabamba community, who are protesting against mining interest. An environmental activist has been found dead in Peru. Peruvian police say they launched an investigation into the death of the 71-year-old British pastor. The body of Paul McCauley was found in a hostel that he owned with what appeared to be burn marks. He was an avid campaigner against oil and mining companies' incursion into the Amazon forest. In 2010, McCauley won a trial against the Peruvian government, which then tried to deport him for allegedly inciting indigenous people to riot. We'll be back very soon. Stay with us. Welcome back. Trinidad and Tobago is no longer in a recession. Trade and Industry Minister Paula Guppy-Schoon made the announcement, saying the country had a small growth for 2018. She says the government is hoping to build on that growth this year, as she called on manufacturers to help in those efforts. Manufacturing contributes over $4 billion U.S. dollars to Trinidad's GDP. Manufacturers are already exploring wider Caribbean and extra-regional markets, such as Cuba.
For the rights of ordinary citizens.
Opposition political parties in Haiti have refused to hold talks with the president, Jovenel Moïse. Talks were scheduled for Monday, but the leader of the Democratic and Popular Movement, André Michel, says all the party wants is Moïse's resignation. He said the party wants a clean slate and is not interested in dialogue or negotiations with Moïse. Two other opposition parties have also turned down Moïse's invitation to attend the meeting. They, too, are demanding that the president step down. The Cayman Islands government plans to appeal a ruling legalizing same-sex marriage in the country. Premier Alden McLaughlin said the government will also seek a stay of execution for Chief Justice Anthony Smelby's ruling. The government has 14 days to file the motion. Last Friday, C.G. Smelly delivered a landmark judgment which favored Chantal Day and her partner Vicky Boden-Bush. The couple brought a joint judicial review and constitutional challenge after government refused their application to marry in April 2018.
But we believe that introducing the entirely new concept of same-sex marriage into the existing marriage law goes way beyond any reasonable interpretation of modification or adaptation. This, we believe, might be inconsistent with the separation of powers by trespassing on the constitutional remit of this legislative assembly.
A one-week gun amnesty is set to start on Sunday in Barbados. Persons with illegal firearms, parts of firearms, and ammunition will have from Sunday, April 7th, until midnight on April 13th to turn them over to the nearest police station. No questions asked. Attorney General Dale Marshall made the announcement during a parliamentary debate on the Bail Amendment Bill 2019. A Pagua parade with a difference has taken place in Queens, New York, to uplift the identities and voices of the LGBTQ Hindu community. The Indo-Caribbean and South Asian Social Justice Organization led the march, with participants waving the rainbow flags during colorful celebrations. They're advocating for full inclusion and the right to practice their religious values equally. Holi, or Fagua, throughout the Caribbean is an ancient Hindu spring festival of unity, renewal, forgiveness, and new beginnings. Algerians have vowed to continue protests to demand a change on the country's government. Before turning in his resignation, President Abdelaziz Bouteflika appointed a 27-member cabinet to run the country until a new president is chosen. However, protesters are calling on the authorities to allow them to choose their own leaders.
We are gathered here against Gaid Salah, who is part system, part of the current regime.
Hopefully the situation will improve. The man was sick and he reached the end. All people get sick and die. We hope again that the situation improves with the new government and the country thrives. Long live Algeria.
And the former president has praised the Algerian youth through a farewell letter, calling them ambitious and optimistic. Bouteflika said humans are prone to make mistakes and that he should be forgiven for all his shortcomings. He says, "I speak to you farewell, and it is not easy to express my true honest feelings towards you." A vaccination campaign has been launched to contain the cholera outbreak in Mozambique's Beira, which was hit by Cyclone Idai. As of Tuesday, officials had reported 1,428 cases of cholera and one death. The outbreak was declared on March 27th. Damage to water and sanitation infrastructure, coupled with the dense population, have raised fears that another epidemic could be difficult to control in Beira.
So this is one of the key issues we have to look at, that really everybody who is concerned has been reached at the end of the day. So in the beginning it will be easy, but then we have to look for those people who might have access problems, maybe in outlying villages and districts where we haven't reached or who cannot come to the immunization centers. That's why we need to get out, we need to go out and reach them. We know that the whole campaign is now planned for 6 days. So within these next 6 days, all the 900,000 people in total four districts should be reached. And again, we're starting today already with more than 500,000 in Beira. We're pretty confident that we'll reach the target.
And in Zimbabwe, a grain milling association has established a program to feed children in Zimbabwe affected by Cyclone Idai. The association has started distributing food to the affected areas, focusing on schools and working with the government to identify areas in need of assistance. Divisions and infighting have escalated in Zimbabwe's main opposition party ahead of its Congress in May. These fighting comes amid allegations that some senior officials of the Movement for Democratic Change are imposing their own candidates. The party secretary general, who is seeking the presidential post, attributed the chaos to some leaders within the party who want to plant hatred between him and the current leader.
What is ironic in the MDC is that the people who are bringing these allegations are people who split from the party, who took money away from the party, and who called Tsvangirai all sorts of names. And they came back to the party, we have accommodated them, and what they are trying to do is to drive a wedge between myself and Nelson Chamisa as a way of getting an accommodation. Fortunately, MDC members are intelligent enough to read through this.
Angry residents in the township of Alexandra in South Africa have staged a shutdown protest over increasing illegal structures and service delivery in the area. Hundreds of protesters are demanding better services and living conditions from the government ahead of national elections next month. Various streets were barricaded with burning tires and rocks.
We are fighting for Alexandra and we want Ramaphosa to come here so we can talk him face to face. There are a lot of things happening here in Alexandra. Locals have no jobs, instead foreigners have jobs. We are not fighting anyone. We just want Ramaphosa to come here so we can speak to him. Even where I come from, it's the same situation. So Ramaphosa needs to come here so we can confront him. We are fighting for our rights.
We'll take a short break now. Join us again after this. Welcome back. The British Prime Minister Theresa May and the leader of the opposition Jeremy Corbyn have met to discuss the UK's Brexit plan. The offer of talks from the Conservative leader shows she wants to avoid a no-deal Brexit, which is set to happen on April 12th. No deal is the preferred option for some right-wing elements in the Conservative Party. The Labour Party leader was expected to argue for a closer relationship with the EU, along with protections for workers' rights and the environment.
Mr. Speaker, I welcome the Prime Minister's offer for talks following the meetings that I've held with members across this House and look forward to meeting her later today, and I welcome her willingness to compromise to resolve the Brexit deadlock. Yeah.
And in the context of a growing climate of right-wing radicalization in the UK, footage has emerged of British soldiers on duty in Afghanistan using the face of Labour Party leader Jeremy Corbyn for target practice. The Ministry of Defence has confirmed the footage legitimacy. Moving on, Brazil's football legend Pelé is recovering at a hospital in France after he collapsed in his hotel room in Paris. The 78-year-old came down with high fever after he met French forward Kylian Mbappé as part of an advertising campaign. The planned meeting with Mbappé had already been postponed last November due to Pelé's health problems. He is, however, said to be doing well as doctors continue to monitor his recovery. The Costa Rica International Film Festival has kicked off, showing over 100 shorts and features from the country and Central America. This year, films are delving into issues relating to gender parity and are being produced from a woman's perspective.
This film festival instills national pride in Costa Ricans, who are excited for the opportunity to see locally produced films on the big screens.
I think it's very important for us to accurately portray Costa Rica and demonstrate how the country has been changing.
The film festival is of great significance and serves as a place for enjoyment and recreation. Not to mention, people are able to see films that are produced right here in Costa Rica.
It's not that films produced by men are completely bad, but they have had little from the women's perspective and her outlook of the world.
Movies like The Awakening of the Ants, directed by Costa Rican Antonella Sudasadi, show how patriarchy exists in everyday life.
After seeing so much aggressive and microaggressive masculinity, I chose to represent the woman's role in society and how women have continued to uphold such ideologies and demands.
It is quite important for the director to take the lead in film production.
I can say without a doubt that many of these roles were dominated by men before a committee made the decision to have a gender parity in the film festival. That's when things changed.
In this year's festival, 52% of the films were directed by women.
It's great that there are so many female directors because we will obviously evaluate the topics chosen from our point of view. We will control how the story is told, the characters that will be created, and the overall rhythm of the production.
The festival curator has put a special emphasis on highlighting women's creative insights.
It is still very important to take affirmative action because there is a habit of not reflecting the equality that exists between genders.
There are still no laws to govern the audiovisual sector, and that makes it quite difficult for films to be shown to the public. These and other initiatives seek to offer an alternative style of cinema to the Costa Rican people, one that is different from the larger productions they are used to.
Fernando Francia, Telesur, Costa Rica.
Michaela Simpson, popularly known as Coffee, is the youngest reggae artist to reach number one on the Billboard Top 100 chart. At just 19, Coffee's debut EP, Rapture, also made it at the top of the iTunes reggae chart. The spot has also been held by a reggae legend, Bob Marley, off and on for a long period of time. And with that story, we've come to the end of this news brief. These and other stories, as always, find them on our website at telesurenglish.net. And also join us on social media. We are on Facebook, on Twitter, and on Instagram. For Telesur English, I am Stefania Bravo. Thank you for watching.